My father was a studio musician, played for a lot of people like Frank Zappa and a lot of R&B bands and stuff, and was always kind of gone doing that. And then when he was home, he was practicing. And so I always saw it, and I always wanted to do what he did. And he's always shown me different things and given me insight into different bands and different players, and introduced me to almost all of my favorite bands, from Led Zeppelin, the Beatles. He even gave me my first Pantera CD. That is when I knew what style of music I really wanted to do. I needed to know what the hell Dime was doing. And so I spent my formative years working on that.
When I was younger and probably a little bit more impressionable than I am now, I was surrounded with all sorts of, you know, friends growing up that would show up to school wearing certain band shirts or dyeing their hair different colors or riding skateboards. And that's really what I gravitated towards, kind of the rebellious crowd. And they would bring this music to me that was fast, that was aggressive, that was just totally created to piss off my parents. And I just absolutely loved it. I could not get enough of it.
You go to school and you see people wearing different shirts and riding skateboards, or a lot of surfing for me. And music is a soundtrack to that lifestyle always.
The first time I ever picked up a guitar, it was empowering. It was almost like magical sword pulling it from the stone or something, looking at it. My parents took me to a guitar shop. I picked up a cream-colored Squire Strat that was strung right-handed, played it upside down, plugged it in, turned the distortion on full blast, didn't know what I was doing. And at that moment, my life was completely changed forever. I was always attracted to the energy of live shows. I mean, some of my favorite guitar playing is literally when people would pick up their guitars and smash them because it's just awesome. It's just, there's something incredible. There's just a raw emotion. There's an energy. There's certain guitar players that just can't be replicated. You talk about, you know, Dimebag from Pantera or Slash. What they do is, it's magical. With that said, to get to the level that we have enjoyed as a band, to be able to tour around the world and play concerts of our own, write albums, you don't necessarily get there by running around, smashing your guitar. You know, you have to delve into songs and songwriting, and Syn has helped me with that. You know, different styles of guitar, I've learned a lot because of him. And then hopefully I like to think that I showed him some of the, you know, fast muting and
the energy.
Yeah, the energy stuff.
Yeah.
And together we just kind of smush it all together and see what works.
You can come together with an interesting chord or a chord progression, and it's like, well, that sounds cool. What the fuck are you going to do with it? and that takes energy and a vibe. And when I came into this band, there was already a record that was written, and it was very riff-based. I'd never really approached music like that. So to be able to sit there and write energy, which is what to me a riff is, it's all about the energy that you're trying to convey or the energy that you're feeling at that time. We're a really good combination of people because we all have different things that we contribute that make us pretty whole, from, you know, the vision of where you want a record to go, to the vision of what you want a song to sound like, to the technical ability of how to get there sometimes.
I absolutely remember when I decided upon playing Ernie Ball strings, and it was right then and there at the guitar store up in Seattle when I picked up my first guitar ever. They said, what kind of string should we put on it? And I just looked at the brightest colored package and I said, that one. And I didn't know what to pick.
It was, I did the same thing.
That's genius.
Yeah. It was, you know, it caught my eye. And to be honest, I never looked back.
I didn't even know what it was. I was in a guitar store looking for guitars, and I just saw a cool little thing, little logo that just was the coolest thing I had seen in the whole fucking store. And I asked what it is, and they said, well, those are guitar strings. Like, what do you mean? Well, you have to change the strings on your guitar.
I've been literally playing Ernie Ball since the beginning. So at some point, I'm certain we got a box of free strings, and I was so thrilled at that point because we probably really, really needed them. There's really no, like, an official moment when, you know, we signed a board or anything. It was kind of like, these are the strings that we use, and they've gotten us through small gigs of beating up our guitars and beating up the strings, and they've gotten us through hundreds of Warped Tour dates and dust and sand and mosh pits and swinging the guitar around my body like a maniac. Now they're just, you know, comfort, knowing that when the tech throws on a new set of, you know, slinkies, you're getting through the show, you don't have anything to worry about. They're going to sound great, they're going to stay in tune, they're certainly not breaking, and it's really the last thing that you have to worry about on stage, which is awesome.
You guys were the first people to give us free strings, and then when you try other things, whether you're in the studio or people have different stuff, then you quickly realize, you know, what separates the men from the boys, and the constant innovation that Ernie Ball continues to do. That's what keeps us a part of this great family, you know, because you don't need free stuff at a certain point anymore. When you're a kid, your band's starting to get a little bit bigger, you still don't have any money, and the free stuff's great, but now it's all about quality and what you want to use and what you trust.
Writing an album and you're fighting battles and you're you know, you get excited about certain ideas and it's like the best day ever, and then you're, you know, you get super bummed out and you feel discouraged at times. And I feel like that's kind of what we do with every album. It's hard. You want to do something great, you know, you want it to come from the heart, and you have, you know, a want and a desire to make the best music that you can and to tell a story or really capture where you're at in a certain place in your life, but you have to do that with five other people that have five other stories and five other places that they're at in their life, and you have to bring it all together and try and create something that's going to relate to your fans.
You want to do things differently, but you don't want to do things disingenuously. You really want to speak from the heart and from the soul, and it takes a bunch of people and red tape to get through sometimes, and the majority always fucking rules, and some days that breaks your heart, and some days those are fucking great victories.
Sin will always write guitar parts that are way too hard for me to play, and I'll try my very best to learn how to play them, and I usually can. For that, it makes me a better guitar player, and I nitpick everything that he does in the studio, because that's kind of my job in the band to do, but it makes for a good dynamic.
Everything down to from the lyrics to the production, solos to the writing, it's all democratic. At the end of the day, you know, when you're all done with the grind, which it is always an incredible grind for us to write records, I think it makes it that much more special to hear the final product and to go tour it. And when you're in front of your fans again. You don't feel like you're up there, you know, shying away from these songs that you're playing. You're just up there excited to share that with them.
At a point where we have the ability to influence a younger generation of, you know, up-and-coming guitarists, musicians, music lovers, just to have fans is still a weird concept, because it doesn't feel like that long ago that we were struggling so hard to have one fan, and that turned into five fans, and it really did. We literally played concerts in front of one person. I don't even know how we did that, but we gave it our all. We played our hearts out.
One of the most solid foundations, besides the necessity being the mother of invention, is that contrarian thought is the father of invention. And that's, if somebody's doing it that way, try to do something the opposite and see, just to see what happens. And a lot of times you'll find that doing something the polar opposite of something that you really, really enjoy doing brings about something innovative and unique. So you do that with music, do that with life, you'll stop following and grow towards more of that leader of the pack type that I think is what you want. You certainly want that in the artists that you're growing up listening to and your favorite artists. You like that there's nobody else like that. So be nothing like anything else.